Hey, welcome back to another Full Moon podcast. I'm your host, Stephen Whitsitt, and this is an Elijah's Bones production. Welcome back to everybody who, I don't know, maybe somebody has missed me in the last few months. I have finally have finished my dissertation. It's been submitted. Within 3 weeks, I will be defending it. But technically, at one point, that will be when I can call myself the PhD doctor. But until then, of course, I'm still the PhD, what they call all but dissertation. I finished all my classwork and all of that. The paper is done and submitted. So we're just waiting for the last few steps. It's been a long road, long journey, but finally, the day of its completion has come. All things are now fulfilled, and I'm ready to receive my diploma. Okay, that's a little joke there. What we're going to be dealing with is, and here's the thing, is I've been hearing a lot of different things over the last few months, but I haven't been able to really take the time to respond, of course, because of what I've been doing. But a lot of stuff. This video from All Things Fulfilled, William Bell, How Preterism Debunks Premillennial Dispensation was a pretty easy one to kind of deal with and give an answer back. It's about 20 minutes long, and what he is doing is he's giving five reasons as to why he thinks preterism debunks premill. So I'm going to take about 15 minutes with each point. Not quite as long as he did with all of them, but I still want to point out some things and why he actually is not debunking anything, but just pointing out his own errors. And with that said, though, of course, let's get going with just this is the introduction.
Is debunked by preterism. So let's go ahead and share the screen and get underway. How and why preterism debunks premillennial dispensationalism. Our text that we're going to use is Matthew 8, 11, and 12.
All right, let's look at it real quick. Of course, I'm going to head him off at the pass. This is 8, 11, and 12. This is the story about the centurion who had a servant that was paralyzed and suffering terrible, and he wanted Jesus to heal him, and he told him, Jesus, you don't have to come to my house. Just say it, and it will happen. And Jesus' response, of course, was, truly, I tell you, with no one in Israel have I found so much or such faith. So he tells you, I tell you, many will come from the east and the west and recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven when they come into heaven, while the sons of the kingdom will be thrown into outer darkness. So this is an idea of judgment, but doesn't tell you when. There is no idea of when this is going to happen. It's just a statement of what's going to happen at these two at this one time. So Abraham and Isaac, Jacob, at the end of the Gentiles, there's going to be a time when they are going to be sitting down and together while these people that have been cast out. And the point that he's trying to make, of course, is what he tries it in time is it was written to them. Therefore, it had to happen to them and had to happen within 70 AD when this casting out of the sons of darkness. Well, let's head something off at the pass here right from the very beginning. As a historic premillennialist, when looking at the early church fathers, there is very much a consensus that where many agreed that 70 AD was the time of the destruction. It was the days of vengeance, which every prophecy written about those days was fulfilled. Get that straight. Luke 21:21. The idea is that not all prophecy is being fulfilled during those days of vengeance, but those are the days of vengeance when all the prophecies written about it would happen. Now, this is the exact same thing that Luke talks about with Jesus. Let me go. Okay, I don't want to take the time to go through the screen, so I'll pause it and go to it. Look at Luke 22:37. He says what? For I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in me, and he was numbered with the transgressors. And so he's quoting the Old Testament passage when he's talking about that. For what is written about me has its fulfillment. Let's look at this. This one's real quick. Doesn't take much to get to. Then he said, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was with you, that everything written about me in the law of the Moses, the prophets, and Psalms must be fulfilled. And then days of vengeance. Days of vengeance. It's kind of the same idea that gets across there, 21:22. For these are the days of vengeance, to fill all that is written, to fulfill that was written about the days of vengeance, to fill all that was written about Jesus and his home life. Let me show. Yeah, Luke 16. Kingdom of God. It is easier heaven and earth pass away than for one dot of the law to become void, right? So he is there to fulfill everything. Everything of the law and the prophets were the good news of the kingdom is preaching and when first is that way, but it's easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one dot of the law to become void. And that means not fulfilled. Okay, so by looking at these scriptures, then the thing that is comes across there is that nobody, and if I was to go back to that Luke 21:22 example, man, my computer is fast. I'm so happy. For these are the days of vengeance to fulfill all that was written. For the time of the punishment and fulfillment, all this has been written. There is no commentary where anybody ever suggested that these were the days where all prophecy was fulfilled. Nobody has ever stood it that way. The words answer the great tribulation. The word venture may have been chosen as delusion, but the other characters must say, Luke, things which are written, everything that which is written. That is the main thing that all get across. Daniel 9:26, after 62 weeks, the Messiah will be fled. Those are the talking about all those things that are going to be fulfilled. Everything that was written in Deuteronomy to be fulfilled about these days of vengeance. And so there is no sense in the sense that all prophecy is going to be fulfilled. It just, it's not there, folks.
We'll be underway with that in just a moment. First, let me give just a brief overview of the preterist view and the premillennial dispensational view. Preterism is the view that all Bible prophecy was fulfilled when Jerusalem and the temple was destroyed by the Romans in 70 AD, according to Luke chapter 21, verses 20 through 22, where he says, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation is near. Then in verse 22, he says, for these are the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. In verse 32, he says that generation wouldn't pass until all those things took place.
And so we agreed. 70 AD was the day when all the days of vengeance and everything written about those things would be fulfilled. That is what it is. And the fulfillment is the destruction. That is what they are talking about. That's what happened in 70 AD. Those were the days of vengeance to fulfill everything written about them.
Now, the premillennial dispensationalist view believes in a 1,000 years reign. So at some time before an alleged future return of Christ, he will come reign on earth in Jerusalem for 1,000 years, after which time he will come to judge the world at the great white throne judgment and then wrap up everything in the second coming of Christ.
Okay, let me go back. I'm going to show you where that comes from. One of the main arguments that we understand that supports this view. And I will tie the knots here before you. Okay, so it talks about in Zechariah 14, there's days of city go into exile, people want to cut off, and the days of it, then the Lord will go out and fight against those nations as when he fights on a day of battle, which was never the same day. He didn't go after Babylon on the same day that he destroyed Jerusalem. He waited. It was always after. But on that day, his feet shall stand in the Mount of Olives that lies before Jerusalem on the east, and Mount Olives will be split in two. Then the Lord my God will come and all the holy ones with him. This is 1 Thessalonians 3:13. Paul quotes it there. It's talking about the time of his coming. When he comes, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives. Okay, feet is physical. He stands there. What happens on that day that he does that? It's a unique day. There's no day, no evening. There's no light. So did that happen in 80 to 70? The Lord will be king over the earth on that day. The Lord will be one and his name one. The land will be turned to a plain from Geba to Ramoth. Was there this big earthquake that shifted everything? Benjamin to the place of the foreign gate, to the garden gate, from the tower of Hanel to the king's white press. But did it all stay there? And it shall be inhabited, for there shall never again be a decree of destruction. Jerusalem shall dwell in security. Here's the idea, folks. Jerusalem will dwell in security. Not the new Jerusalem, the same one that Jesus comes down to and defends. Oh, defends? Oh, well, yeah, let me show you that. Let's go back to verse 12. Almost identical. On that day, the Lord will protect the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the feeble. Among them on that day will be like David. And on that day, the day I will seek to destroy all the nations that come against Jerusalem. Okay, Zechariah 5:14. And on that day, there should be, what day? The same day that he came, right? That his feet stood on the mountain of things. What will happen? That everyone who survives of all the nations that have come against Jerusalem shall go up year after year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to what? Keep the feast of booths. And if any families do not go up to worship the King, there will be no rain on them. Year after year. What does that imply? Jesus comes back. He defends Jerusalem from this attack that's going on. He is there in Jerusalem. And he's telling the nations to come year after year. What does that imply? That there is a millennial kingdom going on there. Jesus is returned. The restoration of everything is when Jesus returns and he sits on the throne of his father David, as Peter took the time of the restoration. Acts 1. Well, Lord, at this time, will you restore the kingdom of Israel? No, it's not for you to know when. I'm not telling you you ain't going to do it. I'm telling you that you're not to know when. I want you to do this. Go into Jerusalem, wait, and the Holy Spirit will come and da-da-da-da. So, no, sorry, folks. Everyone who survives the nation that came against Jerusalem. Okay, Jerusalem has to exist in order for an army to come against them. And if that happened in 70 AD, who won? Then everyone who survives of the nations, not Jerusalem, you see that just doesn't work. It shall continue, like here in verse 8, it shall continue in summer as in winter. Again, it indicates there's time that goes on. A unique day, which is neither day or night, but time shall there be light. So time is continuing on. After what? After that day, and when he stands on the Mount of Olives, it lies before Jerusalem 8 on the east. Acts 1, the Lord himself will return. 1 Thessalonians 4, Jesus himself will descend. Every eye will see him, and we shall see him as he is. Those are the things that argue and present a challenge to the preterist about the 1,000 years being literal and when he comes. When he comes to judge the world, no, he came to judge at that time who? Israel, not the world. He didn't destroy the world of the ungodly, as 2 Peter says, doesn't look at that 2 Peter thing very closely. To destroy the works of men and the world of the ungodly, not the Jews. The Jews are not the ungodly. Oh, definitely, that word ungodly was never used towards Jews.
Now, let's look at five reasons why this is false in view of the text in Matthew chapter 8, 11, and 12. Reason number one, Christ's coming is the time when the Jews or the sons of the kingdom are cast out. Jesus said, many will come from the east and west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom, but the sons of the kingdom will be cast into outer darkness. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Now,
okay. Real quick, we're going back to Matthew 8, and or is it 18? Did I get that right, or was it Matthew 8? See, I'm dyslexic. I never know. the centurion came to him about his servant, and he said, okay, and he healed him. Didn't ask Jesus to go to his house, said, you can just heal him, he did. So Jesus responds, man, this is great faith. But I'll tell you the truth. He's not a Jew, is he? He was not a Jew. He was not one of the sons. He's a centurion. He's a Roman soldier. Well, there's going to be a day when I tell you when many will come from the east and the west and recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, many Gentiles, in the kingdom of heaven, in the kingdom which is in heaven, when the sons of the kingdom will be thrown out in the outer darkness. So yes, there's a day coming when Gentiles will recline at the table with him, and those people will be cast out. The question is then, did that judgment happen in AD 70? Well, the bottom line there is that nobody is going to be judged in absentia. You have to stand before the court. Paul said, every man must stand before the Lord in judgment to give an account for the deeds of what he did while in the body. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Every person in Revelation 20 will stand before the Lord and be judged all at once. No one in any court of law anywhere in this world do a group of people or people or anything else get judged without standing forth the great white throne judgment in absentia. In other words, after 70, they claim that everybody was judged. So when they die, they either go to heaven or to hell. God always gives you an account, a day of an accounting of when you get to stand before him, give an account of your life, of why you did what you did, and why you rejected him. That is justice. It is not justice to condemn somebody without allowing them to have a defense or say their piece or whatever you want to might call it. Every man's got to stand before the Lord. This is why Russell said the judgment was still future, because he accepted the fact that nobody is going to be judged without standing before God in front of him at the bema seat at the end and the last time. So that's why we say that judgment is future.
Now, the time when Israel was cast out was 70 AD. When we turn to Matthew 21, verses 41.
But Revelation also shows that there was, 144,000? So there is a perfect number of people that are not cast out. They are not cast out. So it wasn't everybody, was it?
1 through 43, in the parable of the vine dressers, when they had spurned the prophets who brought them the message of God in the parable, Jesus asked, you know, what will the Lord do to those men, or the parable asked? And he says, they will miserably destroy those wicked men and will take the kingdom from them and lease it to another nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. Again, the time when the kingdom was taken from national Israel was in 70 AD. Paul says the same thing when he talks about the two covenants and the two women and the two sons in Galatians chapter 4, verses 21 through 31, saying in verse 30, cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So again, when Israel was cast out, that's national Israel, for rejecting the Messiah and refusing to repent, that was 70 AD. Now, premillennial dispensationalists claim that national Israel
would be gathered at the second coming. This is a distinction, yes, that they make. I agree. This is why he can poke holes at dispensationalism, because they say things like this. But the problem is that when he gathers all his saints to him, there'll be a perfect number of Jews that will come in, a perfect number of Gentiles, and you can't get away from that. We are not saying, the Bible says natural Israel are scattered at the coming of Christ, national Israel. Why do they make that distinction? Because they weren't scattered. The Bible says national Israel are scattered at the coming of Christ. They never were. And if I look closely,
Israel would be gathered at the.
It doesn't say scattered. What does it say again? It doesn't say they are scattered. What? While the sons of the kingdom would be thrown into outer darkness. That's not scattering. That's being thrown into the lake of fire. So there's no scattering in that verse. What's the other one he puts up here? Matthew 21, and let's go there real quick. Matthew 21, 41 through 43. Let's see real quick. We will put those wretches to miserable death and lay out the vineyard to other tents who will give the fruits. Have you read the scripture? The stone build rejected to become the corns. This was the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous. Now, therefore, I tell you, the kingdom will be taken away from you and given to people producing its fruit. And the one falls in the stone with broken piece, and when it falls in anyone, it will crush him. Where does it say that they're being scattered? It says they're being judged. And then Galatians 4:30. I want to show you, this is what he does. By twisting and interjecting things that don't belong there. Galatians 4:30. Okay. Where does it say they're scattered? Now, the brothers of Isaac and children of promise, but it's just the time he was born according to the flesh, persecuted, who was born according to the spirit. So also it is now. But when does the scripture cast out the slave of the woman, her son? For the son of the slave one shall not inherit with the son of the free. So, brothers, we are not children of the slave, but of the free. Where does it say that the sons are being scattered? It doesn't. That's what he does. He interjects
the second coming, but that is not true. We've just seen that according to Matthew 8, 11, and 12, they would be scattered. Now, there are those who were the sons of the kingdom that would be gathered. So you have both a gathering and a scattering, not just a gathering, not just a scattering, but you have both at that time. And that's what John the Baptist says in Matthew chapter 3, verses 10 through 12, when he talks about the harvest where some would be gathered, others would be burned. Then the Bible shows.
Now, he's a little bit more accurate. They would be gathered, the sheaves are gathered also, and they are destroyed, the others are given eternal life. They're not scattered.
That at that time, national Israel are scattered, was the coming of Christ. It was the time of judgment, because in Luke chapter 13, verses 27 and 28, when the Jews come saying, Lord, we ate and drank in your presence, you taught in our streets, he says, depart from me, I never knew you, workers of iniquity. So it's a time of judgment. And he says, and many will come from the north, south, the east, and the west, and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of God when you yourselves are cast out into the outer darkness. So we've got to determine who we're going to believe. Are we going to believe God, or we are?
See, it never says anything about scattered, but for the days are coming when they will see a blessing of the barren in the wombs and ever born breast in them. Where does it say there were great most people whom were mourning? I'm confused there. Luke 13. Oh, maybe that's why I'm confused. Not 23. All right, let's go back to 13. Luke 13, 27 and 28. Boom. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you were yourselves cast out. The people come from east and west and from north and south and recline at the table in the kingdom of God. In the kingdom of God. Behold, some of the last who will be first and some were first will be the last. So the judgment. You see, introduces words and concepts and things that are not exactly there. That is the problem. That is why we declare and renounce and refute full preterism, because those kind of things that they do. Thank you for listening. I want you to look at it yourself. I know this is his one reason, number one, is that we're saying gathered, scattered. It's not even a point that it even really needs to be brought up in one sense, but hey, he brought it up. I showed you that he does not stick to with the things. He's interjecting things about them being scattered when it says nothing about them being scattered. It says they're being gathered together for judgment. All right, thanks for listening. And we're at 24 minutes. The next one should be part two. Will be a lot shorter, obviously, because I'm not doing the introduction things and all of that. So with ado, we will come back and give you part two. Thanks.